singing tonight. I tell you what, heaven's getting sweeter. The closer we get to it, amen.
Yes.
And we closer now than we've ever been. We're one day closer to going home. Could be tonight, amen. This could be tonight. The Lord Jesus steps out, calls the church home. Could be tonight. Through there, we go home. I tell you what, here, there, and in there, just to know where we're going is what the difference maker is, amen.
Amen.
So I appreciate all the singing that's done for us tonight. Appreciate the good report, Brother Van, and we thank God for what he's doing. And we are praying that the Lord will continue to just have his hand on the work there. And what I want y'all to do in the next week or a couple of weeks, is let us know what you want in that pantry down there. Let us know what you want. And church, we're going to take the month of February and we're going to do a food drive for that pantry down there.
Amen.
We're
going to
just fill that thing up and run it over. But now tell me what you like, amen. Man, don't do me no good if you bring me no banana pudding, amen. I don't need banana pudding. Y'all write down what you like, you write down what you know, need, and you get me that in the next couple of weeks, and we're going to set aside the month of February. And we're going to take care of that home down there and take care of this preacher and his family. And so we'll be excited about that and need to go down and do the work anyway. So we'll just do that for the month of February. And then some of you boys got a big old pickup. We'll load that thing down. Amen. Go down one day and deliver some groceries. So thank the Lord for that. And just good to see you in the Lord's house tonight. Well, Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter number 4, I preached my long points this morning, amen. I preached my short points tonight. Had a six-point sermon, and had no idea the order I was even going to preach these points, but the Lord just worked it all out this morning, and so we'll finish this message up tonight that the Lord really laid on my heart. My people know I love the book of Acts. I love to preach out of the book of Acts. I thank God for this record that he's given us of all that he was doing as the heart of God really goes into action through the church in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 3, all that starts in it, we know by the time we get to chapter 3, the day of Pentecost has already been. Simon Peter stood up, he's preached, 3,000 have been saved, man, the church is on fire. They go to the temple in Acts chapter 3, heal the lame man. Man, I tell you what, it sets everybody off. Simon Peter looks around. He's standing on Solomon's porch. They've drawn a great crowd over this man that's been lame all his life. He's leaping. He's running around. He's praising God. And Simon Peter says, man, what a time to preach. Amen. And so he just flies into preaching. According to chapter 4, there's only been about 5,000 saved now. And man, they're in trouble. They put them, they bind them up, they beat them, they put them in prison overnight. They threaten them and they do all these things thinking they're going to silence them. But really all it does is spurs them on. And we talked about how in Acts chapter 4, verse 23, it says, and being let go, that's Peter and John, says they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. And we talked about how God set some things in motion 2,000 years ago, and we're still living them out in these days. Amen. I tell you, every time we get an opportunity to come together from out there in here and let one another know what's going on, why? Because we're the same company, amen. We've been saved, been washed by the blood of the Lamb, amen. The Holy Spirit lives inside of us. And so all of this persecution has come, but God's about to use this persecution to draw a line in the sand, if you will, between those who've been born again and between the lost world. And boy, we really found ourselves in the first five words of verse number 31. They've been driven to prayer, you might say, because of the trouble that Peter and John had got in, because of the trials that they faced. And we talked about how verse 31 in these first five words, they're really a starting place for the church. And it says, and when they had prayed. And when they had prayed. And I talked about how how that was said of the church in that day, that they were a praying church, and no doubt it can still be said of the church today. Every church would probably say we're a praying church, and so it was said of them and when they had prayed, and it could be said of us today when we had prayed. But I talked about the question that came to my mind was, then what? Then what? What happened after they had prayed? We're all oftentimes driven to prayer through some trial or some trouble or some tragedy, some sickness, some worry, or some fear. We all know what it is to be driven to the place of prayer, but then I wonder, then what? We talked about this morning how what happened then after this early church had prayed, what took place. We talked about, were there any real changes in their lives? Did any glorious results come out of this prayer? And when they had prayed, then what? And we talked about if this is all we had was that statement when they had prayed, if nothing had taken place, they might never have prayed again. If there had been no results, they might have said prayer was a waste of time. But thank God that's not a period there, that's a comma, amen. When they had prayed, that prayer brought some results. Prayer worked in that day in church. Prayer still works in this day.
Amen.
Well, we looked at when they had prayed, then what? And those first three points this morning, I said point number one, when they had prayed, they were filled with the Holy Ghost, amen. That's what it said in verse number 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And so, the first thing that happened when they had prayed, then what? It said they were filled with the Holy Ghost. Why? Because God let them realize the greatest need they had in that day was for the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost to be so alive in their lives. And we talked about there's nothing more depressing than a dead church where the fires went out on the altars, but there's nothing more exciting than a church where the fires on the altar still burn hot and people come and they cry out for a filling of the Holy Spirit. And we talked about how at salvation, how the Holy Spirit moves inside of us, and from that moment on He dwells in us, but how we need to constantly pray for that power, that filling of the Holy Spirit, that He might equip us to do that we couldn't do. Amen. We talked about how we live in very dark days, and if you remember this morning, I said we live in days of such darkness that the devil has us deceived. He has us thinking about things like talking to the dead and things like that. And I made a statement this morning. Somebody said, "Preacher, do you believe in all that? And if people really do that?" Well, I don't know if they can or not. I ain't a fool with them, amen. I ain't interested in talking to the dead. I want to talk to the one who's alive.
Amen.
It's one who I want to talk to. Well, I want to talk to the one who can fill me with power and enable me to do that I can't do it myself. Oh, hear me tonight, church, and when they prayed, then what? Hey, they were filled with the Holy Ghost. And you can't stop a Spirit-filled church.
Yeah, right.
Not only were they filled with the Holy Ghost, they spake the Word of God with boldness, is what it says there in verse 31. I'm amazed after that feeling comes. Boy, there's a great courage that comes with that. And we talked about how prayer will bring courage. And I related to when we were in Iraq in 2005, how it was amazing how the fear would be in those men's eyes before we went out on those missions. But it was amazing when we would pray and ask God to fall on us and to take care of us and to count those angels round about us, how what may have been a place of fear and for men that may have been one step away from being a coward. Hey, when we pray, courage would come. Thank God tonight, there's still a result for prayer. I don't care what fear you got tonight, you can pray your way through it. Amen. Boy, that courage will show up when they had prayed. Then what? They were filled with the Holy Ghost. They spake the Word of God with boldness. But then I said, I Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. And we talked about that statement, great grace was upon them all. We talked about that grace was a work of beauty in them. And the psalmist saw it in Psalm 90:17, let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us. Oh yes, the church has too many unattractive folk in it in these days. We need some attractive Christians, amen. I'm talking about where grace will shine on you, shine in you, and run out of you. And folks that are around you, they'll want that one that you've got. And we talked about this morning how religion and the deadness of it will run people off. And whether it's a Pharisee or a Sadducee or a hypocrite or a counterfeit, oh, what the church needs in 2018 is for God to find the folk that'll be said of them, and when they had prayed, then what? The grace of God fell on them, and it made them attractive, amen, as they went about. And I made that statement this morning. I ain't never met a godly man or woman who was not attractive, and it made me want to be around them and glean from them and draw from who was running out of them. We used the Apostle Paul for an example this morning, how tradition tells us he wasn't a handsome man, not anything special to look at. He talked like he had a humpback and had that bad eyesight and some physical deformities. But when you find him in the Word of God, anytime he's leaving a group of people that God had led him ministering to, they falling all over him, amen. They hugging on him and kissing him and crying because he's going to leave them. Why? Because it wasn't what they saw with the physical eye. It's what they saw with the spiritual eye. Oh, yes, it says, and when they had prayed, then what? Well, I got three more tonight, and I done not preached a long time again. Amen. But let me say tonight, when they had prayed, then what, Brother Steve? Well, I believe God would have a seat tonight. They became a united people. Verse number 32 says, and the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that all of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. I tell you, when they had prayed, then what? Well, they became a united people. Now, don't miss what's going on here now. There's been 5,000 saved, and they're from all walks of life, and they're from all over, some of them from Jerusalem, some of them that had come into Jerusalem. And can you imagine all the different personalities that have gathered into the church now? And can you imagine some of them didn't look like other ones, some of them didn't talk like the other ones, and it may have very well been that this one rubbed that in the wrong way, that rubbed this in the wrong way. But boy, it said, and when they had prayed, then what? Well, I tell you what, came out of that prayer meeting, said they were of one heart and of one soul. You realize tonight, two people, there's no way they can kneel together before God without coming closer to each other.
Right.
after Jesus comes. Amen.
Right. Right. Right.
Well, I tell you what, when the devil just able to look back and see the body tear itself up from the inside, he's able to say, mission accomplished. I want you to know, a church that is not together, a church that is divided, they'll never win anyone for Christ, but together they can hurl themselves at any task. Boy, John chapter 17, I love what Jesus said, verse 18. He said, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one. As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. What he's saying, preacher, Jesus said, God, this is what I want you to do. I want you to make them one. What he's saying, you can't fake unity. You can't do it. You can't put on unity. A church on its knees together is more powerful than any army that's ever stood on its feet. Hey, when they had prayed, then what? They became a united people. Yeah. Then might I say, when they had prayed, boy, they had a new sense of stewardship. What's it say in verse 34? Neither was there any among them that lacked, for as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold and laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according to he had need. You said, now wait a minute, preacher. Now wait a minute. You telling me that I got to sell everything I got, I got to give it everything I got, I got to bring it to my church. Don't you get verse 34 and 35 ahead of verse 31 and 32, amen? There's an order that we find here. Verse 31 and 32 bring two Bible facts together. In verse 31, we find where they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. In verse number 32, we find they were of one heart and one soul, and they had all things common. You see, for them to ever be able to do what they did in verse 34 and 35, it took that prayer. It took place in verse number 31. It took that filling of the Holy Spirit to ever get them in one heart and one soul and to be of one common thing. Amen. See, you can't get ahead, and that's what this cash and Cadillac crowd, they made it, they perverted the Word of God, and they put the Word of God and changed it around, and say, well, if you'll just give everything, you won't ever want for anything, and things like that, but don't miss what God's order had right here. You see, what happened in verse 34 and 35, it was the outcome of what had happened in verse 31 and 32. From what I see, they didn't call a business meeting and vote on that.
Amen. Yeah.
That wasn't a legislative process that took place. The leaders of the church, they didn't call for that. They were not directed by the apostles to do as they did. What happened, preacher? The Holy Spirit filled them up. And when he filled them up, he took control of them. And it was him who led them to this great act of generosity. Men and women who were so different are now united in a common purpose. Why? Because they were full of the Holy Ghost and because they had all things in common. And when they did what they did in verse 34 and 35, think about it now. This was the beginning of the church. This was the beginning of the Word. I told you this morning, every great revival started right here. Every mission work started right here. The church where we find her today, it all started right here because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were one mind and they were one soul. And there was no selfishness or ambition in this. There was no greed or nobody critical of this. Nobody was suspicious or regretful. This was a movement in the church directed toward the members of the church. See, the outside world had nothing to do with this. Why? Because it said this was those who had believed. The church was still at an infancy. It was at a purity right here. Well, it's had 2,000 years of men putting their hands on it and defiling it and all the places that we find it today. But I'm telling you, when they had prayed, then what? They had a new sense of stewardship. They did not claim to belong to themselves. They did not claim their possessions were their own. They realized they were bought with a price, and they realized that all they had, it mentions lands and houses and money. They realized this isn't ours anyway. What we need to do is put it at the Lord's disposal. Yeah. And when they had prayed, you know what came out of that prayer meeting? They realized they did not own anything. They realized God had just made them stewards over something. You ever look around and think, how in the world did I end up with all this stuff? We bought it and bought it, amen. But I'm going to tell you right now, don't miss this. It says, when they had prayed, then what? That we like them would not cling to an idea of ownership and saying that's mine. I read after one preacher this week. He said, if you've got anything in your life you think you can't live without, you better give it away.
Amen.
He said, you better give it away, because it's not you owning it. It owns you. Boy, God give us here greatest mission of the sense of stewardship. You see, this is not a conviction that was optional for them. It was a conviction that was absolutely necessary because of how God was fixing to use them. Boy, it was a need that had come up in the church and being led by the Holy Spirit. And you see, this was out of devotion. It wasn't out of doctrine. This wasn't doctrine at work. This was devotion at work. We get wrapped up in doctrine. We say, well, the doctrine is that, well, God's word calls for a tithe. It calls for that tenth. It calls for that dime or that first dollar. And but then we get a hold of it and we say, now, is he talking about before taxes or after taxes? And we get to thinking, now, if I don't ever get it in my hand, it really ain't mine. So time may take taxes out of it. I really ain't getting but this much money. And so instead of giving this, I really ain't got to give but this. See, there's no devotion in that. Hey, we pay a tithe, amen. We pay a tithe. I mean, that's just pay your tithe. We give an offering.
Amen.
We pay a tithe, but we give an offering. And you'll never experience the blessing of giving till you stop from going to be one that pays the tithe till you turn into one that gives an offering.
Amen.
But Steve, how do I give an offering? Well, I don't know. It just depends on how the Holy Spirit leads you.
Right.
And it can be more than money. It can be when a missionary comes and he stands up and he was somewhere this morning and said, man, we got to leave for gas dryer. Thank God for the body of Christ over there. They said, we can build a gas dryer. Amen. We can buy a gas dryer. So you know what they did? They came an offering this morning. It had nothing to do with the tithe.
Amen.
They bought a dryer. So what are we going to do? Hey, there's a pantry. Pantry's need food in it. Amen. Hey, I'll tell you what. I want to be part of that, brother. Amen. I want to get in on that. So am I going to take my tithe money one Sunday and go buy some beans and corn? Are you crazy? That's got nothing to do with the tithe.
Amen.
But I want in on the beans and the corn. Amen. Now don't bring me no beans and corn, because I don't eat beans and corn. Honey buns and Diet Coke. Fill it up.
Yes, sir. You got it, bro.
So what you saying, Brother Steve? Hey, after they had prayed, then what? The Holy Spirit filled them. He controlled them. And he began to give them some good sense about stewardship.
Yeah, yeah.
And it wasn't about an amount or anything. Well, they were moved to make everything they had available to God.
Amen.
But Steve, how do I give an offering? Hey, you paid your tenth. But the rest of it, you make available to God.
Right. Yes.
I'm going to tell you what you'll be amazed at. When you make it all available to him, you'll be amazed at how, when he knows you're a vessel, he can pour through you.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
He won't ever let you run out.
Amen. Amen.
What are you saying, preacher? You be sensitive. You but since you saw or received that, they'll take advantage of it. They don't say about taking advantage of nobody. I'm telling you, this wasn't the work that went on in the world. This was the work that went on in the church.
Amen.
And that's where we need to get to going back to. Say, Brother Steve, what if we give it and they misuse it? Hey, that ain't nothing to us, amen. We won't be good stewards of what God pours through this place, and it's all His.
Amen.
After they had prayed, then what? If you're sitting around tonight figuring that you're going to give God too much, you got to pray He ain't on the throne tonight figuring He's going to give you too much.
Amen.
Well, I wasn't even going to preach all that, amen. I'm talking about when they had prayed, then what? Hey, when they had prayed, what did we say? They were filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, they spake the word of God with boldness. They became attractive Christians. They became united people. Well, they had a new sense of stewardship. I got one more, amen. After they had prayed, then what? The place they were assembled was shaken. We find that up in verse number 31 where we started. It's actually the first thing it says, but it's what I want to close out with tonight. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. Now you gotta realize just what all the Holy Spirit's saying when He says this. They're in Jerusalem and they've been going to the same temple and worshiping. Now they've been worshiping different than everybody else has. But they've been in the same temple. And boy, all of that tradition's there. And they've been mixed and mingled in there. But you know what God's doing? He's fixing to draw a line. Well, that dispensation of grace is fixing to set some folks aside what He saved them out of and where He's called them to. Boy, there's going to be a great division, and it's going to come from this place of that was shaken. What are you saying, Brother Steve? Hey, prayer will shake things up. Matter of fact, this was over 2,000 years ago. It started shaking there where they were, and it's still shaking the whole world today. From now to then, of the shaking of prayer, possesses the power to unleash the might of God.
Right.
When people pray, places are shaken. That day it shook a whole nation. Against old ideas and systems and theologies and prejudices and power structures, all being shaken in the very foundations, shaken by the name of Jesus. Well, our prayer is that for the Holy Ghost power to come and to constantly shake some things up, to shake some people up, to tear some things down, to tear down some old houses and lead them to a great house, to tear down some old ideology and bring them into a new theology as they begin to learn the heart of God. Started out with a statement this morning, persecution drove them to their knees. Well, I see from that the Holy Spirit stood them up on their feet. Grace and power began to flow through them. No foe could daunt them. No fear could haunt them. And on with the gospel they went. And their motivation was the love of Christ. They couldn't get over that God so loved the world. He'd say something like this. Their motivation was the love of Christ, and its manifestation came out in the way they shared, in the way they gave of themselves, in the way they gave of their things. Well, the church became a visible demonstration of the oneness of the body of Christ. And all that mutual care and concern and compassion, it was actually a miracle of grace. And what a company it must have been when they had prayed. And boy, they began to go out. And no wonder so many wanted to be a part of it when they had prayed. And church, I tell you, we do well to recapture what they captured in verse number 31. When they had prayed, boy, the place was shaken. Holy Spirit filled them up. Boy, they got courage to speak with boldness. Boy, God moved. And out of that came a great example of a man. We meet him in verse number 36. And Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, a Levite and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. This is where we meet old Barnabas. You'll read more of him as he gets joined up with Paul and as he begins to make those missionary journeys. And it talks about how here in the Hebrew his name means son of consolation, and that would indicate something of the grace that you found in him. But in the Greek, that name means son of exhortation, and that would indicate something of the gift that he had. And so what we see of Barnabas, he was a son of consolation. You see the work of grace. He was a son of exhortation. He had a gift to take that grace out and to use it for the glory of God and how God used him when they prayed. Then what? Well, you'll find three things that stand out about the church as you go on through. You find in that when they had prayed, God raised up a great people. And out of that came some great preachers. And out of that came a great power.
Yeah.
And it all started when they had prayed.
Right.
Good to have our oldest son and daughter Ray for Ted here tonight. And amen. Old Ray. Ray was my deer finder this last week. Amen. I shoot him, he find him. Well, you had her when we started out, they were with us in the little building. All their four codes. And me and Clay, we had conversations from time to time. And Clay would tell me he was the same man, but then there would always be a little question left with him. He'd always just had a little something that he wasn't settled on that. And so they live up the top of it. They live up north of you all. So the Lord just now led their heart to Plainfield Baptist Church. Clay went there and he got busy and made the brotherhood director. Son, they just got, I'm talking about, they got faithful in church. Boy, I tell you what, Clay just he never could get any peace about his salvation. Now, if you've got no peace about your salvation, there's a reason for that. Amen. We don't serve a hope-so God who saves. We serve a hope-so God. So if you're troubled tonight about whether you're really saved, you need to get that nailed down. Amen. Right now, tonight. You just need to get that nailed down. I didn't have this in my notes, but I just laid this on my heart right there.
Go ahead.
And Clay, I got a call from him. Got a call from him just a few months back.
September 12th.
September 12th. He knows the name. Boy, when I answered the phone, Clay said, "Brother Steve, this one's you know. I got saved this morning."
Amen.
6:30 in the morning. There at the house. Nobody knew anything. You had got. Where'd that come from, Brother Steve? That came from a group of people over 2,000 years ago when they had prayed.
Amen.
Amen.
Because see, God knew it wasn't going to do the church no good to stay there in that little group in Jerusalem. He knew there going to be some rednecks in North Mississippi.
Amen.
Needed the gospel. So what did he do? He filled some folk up. He gave them a boldness. He put them of one mind and one soul. They had things in common. They had a common goal. And what did they do then? Well, they began to go out. They were united. Well, that grace had an appeal to it. And it made its way all the way from there, all the way to Cotton Plant, Mississippi, in a young man's house. And me and him sit together tonight. As much as I loved him in the physical realm, a brother in Christ tonight.
Amen.
Because of the perfect word of God.
Right.
Christ.
Yeah.
Honey, you can't do nothing with that, baby.
Right.
That's power.
Yeah. Amen.
That's power. It all came when they prayed.
Yeah.
I'm excited about a girl's home. I'm excited to hear that two came and one got saved.
Amen.
Brother Steve, is that, you know, if they don't ever get another girl, if God closes the door,
Brother Van, it's worth it all.
Amen.
I have one song.
Yes, sir. Amen.
It's worth it to her.
Amen. Yes, sir. Amen.
Worth it to her. If it had been you, it'd be worth it to you.
Yes, sir. Oh, yes.
See, that was their starting place that day. That was their starting place when they had prayed. And you know what? Tonight, it's our starting place, ain't it? There's no telling what's going to come out of this day and this service tonight. Because we've got a fresh look. Then what? Now, I know you tell me you pray, but I want to say, then what? What's coming out of that prayer? Amen.
Yep.
Somehow we'll miss none of it. Amen. I want it on. Let's bow our heads. Josh, y'all come on. Boy, in the stillness of this time, God may have just revealed something in your heart. You may not have a peace about your salvation. Well, I tell you what. I know a man who can give you peace tonight. It'll not be what I tell you, it'll be what he tells you. Why in the world would you go another day and not know him? As I tell you tonight, you can know him. You come before God right now and say, Lord, I'm tired of wondering. God, show me, am I saved? He's going to do one or two things. He's going to carry you to the place he saved you. He's going to continue to trouble your heart. This is your night. This is your place. You need to call on Jesus. Maybe one here tonight, and you just have to say, but Steve, I might quit praying. Just about give up. I haven't seen any results. Well, don't get things out of order. Now the results are going to come when that filling of the Holy Spirit comes. When he gets control of your life, your vessel, that he's able to pour through and use. Boy, that's when the answers will start coming. Maybe tonight you're a coward in some places. You've lost your boldness. You don't say a word for Jesus anymore. Oh, it says that they spoke his name. Telling you what, tonight he's got a faith that will stamp out any fear. You'll just get where he is tonight. Somebody in this service tonight that you just don't really feel right at. Maybe near this time of invitation, you just want to go put your hand in somebody's hand and say, would you come pray with me tonight? Or maybe there's somebody out there in the world you crossed up with and just get a brother or sister in Christ and say, would you help me to be through this thing tonight? I don't want to be a stumbling block. I want to be used to God. Or you may look in that mirror tonight and realize there's no beauty of grace shining through me. Oh, I'm so undefiled. Oh, I've done got so full, so much old Phariseeism. There's so much about me that's not appealing. God, give me that grace that'll make me beautiful to a lost and dying world. Boy, maybe you need some things shaken up in your life tonight. Or some things knocked down, some things gone away with, so God can build up some things. Whatever your need is tonight, it will set of them when they pray. What's going to be said of you? You would pray, Holy Spirit, use this time. God, give victory. Lord, let us leave here tonight. Folks, look at our lives and they'll be able to say then after they pray, God, let it be the start place. Victory tonight. In Jesus' name, we stand with heads bowed and eyes closed. They're going to sing. If you need this preacher, if you need this altar, don't miss God tonight.
The carpet may be tattered, the wood stained with tears. It might seem old-fashioned, but it's stood throughout the years,
where countless souls have come to cry out to the Father, and if only for just one. That's why we have this altar. It's a haven for the broken, for the weary and distressed. And when every fear is spoken, it's where we lay them all to rest. church and these old floors may look a little worn, but it's a place where sinners come and saints are born.
For every mercy seeker, it's the foot of the cross, where every faithful preacher beckons to the lost.
Where Jesus stands and waits, so hear the invitation and come kneel down in faith and trust Him in salvation. It's a haven for the broken, for the weary and distressed. And when every fear is spoken, it's where we lay them all to rest. In this old church, in these old floors may look a little worn, but it's a place where sinners come and saints are born. Come home. It's where we lay them all to rest. In this old church, in these old floors may look a little worn, but it's a place where sinners come.